Jason, cut it out. I won't tell you again.
Wait.
Oh, sorry, Nancy.
Yes.
I'd like to make a complaint.
Look, can you keep the noise down? I can't hear myself think. What's the complaint?
Well, them bailiffs that come round, you know.
Bailiffs?
Yeah. Well, they get me in the kids' bedroom, right? Tried to touch me up, both of them. Shut up, Jason!
Morning.
Can you give us a
won't tell
you again.
Mrs.
Houston.
Mrs. Houston, this is PC Marshall, and perhaps you could take Mrs. Houston off somewhere quiet. Would you come through here, Mrs. Houston?
Right.
Cheers.
A quiz?
Yeah.
What's the matter with you, Reg? This is the Nick, not your local pub.
Yeah, well, that is where I got the idea from, is it? It's damn me local.
Okay, next!
So, who's setting the questions, then?
I am.
Well, let's put a kibosh on it for a start. You don't know anything, Reg.
I have got books.
Come on.
Yes, sir, can I help you?
Yes. My name is John Chamberlain. This is my wife, Christine Chamberlain. We live at number 93, Broadacre Lane. Do you know it?
Yeah.
Up by Tollyton Hill Field. To get to our house, you go past the Star Public House, past the shopping centre on your left, past the first set of traffic lights...
Not a second set. The first set's a pedestrian crossing.
Past the second set of traffic lights. Number 93 is the third house on the left. It's the only one with a bay window.
Right, yes, I see.
Now, we're telling you this just in case you want to talk to us later, because we're not always in, you see. I work 3.5 days a week these days, and my wife goes out quite a bit, shopping and that, and seeing friends.
Mr. Chamberlain, why exactly have you come to see us?
Our next-door neighbour, number 91. We haven't seen her for several days.
Right, I see. OK, can you give me her name?
Sheridan.
Is she married?
Not as far as we know.
So she lives on her own?
Yes.
How old is she?
Quite young. 30.
About 30.
Have you tried knocking on her door?
Why should we want to do that?
Well, to see if she's all right.
Oh. No, we haven't.
So how well do you know her?
Well, we don't. She's just someone who lives next door. We don't like to make a fuss.
Do you know if she has a job?
Oh, yes. Well, she's got a job. I think she's got a job. We see her going off in the mornings, all dressed up, smart, then back again in the evenings.
But not for a few days?
No.
How many days exactly?
Oh, we saw her last Wednesday.
Wednesdays. 6 days.
That's right, 6 days ago.
Of course, it's just possible that Miss Sheridan has gone on holiday.
On holiday?
Yes, taking a few days off work.
To go where?
Well, I don't know. Anywhere. Or she might have decided to spend a few days at home. That's why you haven't seen her.
Oh, no. No, she's not. She's not there. She's not at home. She's not in the house.
Well, how can you possibly know that if you haven't bothered to knock and find out?
Because it's nice and quiet.
Quiet?
Yes.
How do you mean quiet?
Peaceful. For a change.
Are you saying, then, that you've got a noisy neighbour?
They come home, make enough noise to wake the dead.
Oh.
Everyone. The whole world's full of noise these days. In the streets, in the parks, everywhere. You just can't get away from it. It's a form of violence, you know, noise.
Yes. Look, can you just wait there a minute? Sarge, I think I've got a weird one here.
So what sort of questions are you going to ask?
Well, I thought I'd leave crime right out.
Good idea. You wouldn't get many correct answers.
No, well, look, I've decided on four categories. Sport, popular music, geography and one other. Maybe films.
What about the arts in general?
The arts?
Yeah. Well, not all sport and film freaks, you know. There's some serious music lovers in this place. I've heard Mr. Brownlow sing snatches of opera in his washroom.
Is that what it was? Hey, Tony, what do you know about the arts?
That's easy. It's a football club in Scotland, isn't it?
This neighbour of yours, Miss Sheridan, apart from not having seen her for several days, is there anything else that's made you at all suspicious?
Like what?
Well, like milk on the doorstep, papers in the letterbox.
Anyway, I don't think she has her milk delivered.
Oh, she doesn't.
Do you happen to know if she has any relatives living in the area?
No.
Friends? Well, it's very good of you and your wife to come and tell us about this, Mr. Chamberlain. I'll get someone to take a look.
What about us?
You and your husband? Well, there's nothing...
Can we stay here while you take a look?
Yeah, if you wish.
Thank you.
Tony! You finished in custody?
Yes, Sarge. Just on my way back out on patrol.
Good.
So I've got a little job for you. Tony Stamp's on his way out to Broadacre Lane.
Oh, good.
Look, why don't you go get yourself a cup of tea? I'll take care of this till you get back.
Yeah, but...
Don't worry about them. They're only doing what we're always telling the public they ought to do anyway.
I know, but they don't talk to each other.
What?
Those two. They only talk to us.
So what?
Even when they're sitting alone together, they don't talk to each other.
Maybe they've been married too long.
And all that funny stuff about the noise. Earlier on, it was chaos out there, but they just sat through it as if, I don't know, as if they switched themselves off from it. As if it wasn't there.
What's wrong with that?
I don't know.
Excuse me.
Good luck.
Yes, Mr. Chamberlain.
I'm not a religious man, you know.
They say it takes all sorts.
Neither is my wife religious. I suppose by saying that, I mean we don't go to church regularly. I never have, couldn't be bothered with it. But we both believe in leading a good life. And we both believe in justice. Eternal justice, if you like.
What, you mean like hell and damnation?
No, that's not what I mean at all. You know, I've worked hard all my life.
Glad to hear it. What do you do?
Well, I've told you. I only work 3.5 days a week at the moment. That's enough for me.
Yes, but what do you do?
I'm a butcher. You know, people do get paid back for the sins. In the long run. My wife and I both believe that.
Mr. Chamberlain, is that what you wanted to talk to me about?
Not quite, no.
Well, look, before we go any further, is there anything you wanted to say to me?
My wife would like to use the toilet.
Jim, sorry. Mr. and Mrs. Chamberlain,
yeah.
I want you to book them in as visitors. Show Mrs. Chamberlain to the loo and then put them both in the front interview room. Oh, and you may as well get them a cup of tea as well.
Right, Sarge.
Hey, why?
Because you're right. There's something odd about those two. Very odd.
Have there been any other reports that the neighbour has gone missing?
No, sir.
So, who have you sent out to take a look?
PC Stamp.
Well, you know what it's like in the front office as well as I do, John. You get the oddballs and the time wasters. They need a bit of drama in their lives, but they don't read books and there's nothing on the telly. So, they make the drama up themselves, and then come here and tell us all about it. You're still not sure about them?
No, sir, I'm not.
No Chamberlain J?
Yeah, try the wife's name, Kristen.
Same address?
Yeah.
So what have this Mr. and Mrs. Chamberlain been up to?
That's what I'd like to know.
The same. No arrests entered under that name.
All right. Thanks, Donna.
What was she doing?
When?
When you saw her.
And she was going to work.
That's right, she was going to work.
So it was in the morning, I presume?
Yes.
At what time?
About 5 to 8. She always leaves home at about 5 to 8.
You saw her too, did you?
Yeah, I just said so.
No, your wife said so. You had to think about it.
Yes, well, I did see her. I remember now.
So you went to work that morning?
No.
I thought the butchers had to start work early.
They do. Only if you'd listened when I first told you, you'd know I only work 3.5 days a week.
Yes, but you didn't tell me which 3.5 days.
Well, if it's of any help, Tuesdays, Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturday mornings.
Thank you.
We can't be expected to remember everything, you know, like it was yesterday.
Mr. Chamberlain, We're really very grateful for you and your wife coming here to talk to us. You've acted like good citizens.
Yes.
How does Miss Sheridan get to work?
She catches the bus.
Which bus?
Well, I don't know, do I?
The number 17A.
Oh, yes.
Stops by the shops. Sometimes she comes home by taxi.
Taxis? All right, for some.
She's not a car owner, then?
No. No, thank goodness. That's all we need. Car doors slamming late at night.
Does Miss Sheridan often get home late?
It depends what you mean by late. Car doors are car doors. They're there to be slammed by some people.
But you said she doesn't own a car.
She slams doors in the house.
You've heard her?
We can't help but hear her. People in Broadacre Lane don't have the opportunity to live in detached houses.
And that makes you angry, does it?
What?
The noise.
No. It makes me sad. Sad that some people can have no consideration whatsoever for others.
Do you feel the same way about things, Mrs. Chamberlain?
Of course she does.
I'm asking your wife. Well, do you?
Yes.
I don't suppose either of you happen to know where Miss Sheridan works.
At Burraford, you could feel the peace and quiet. On hot days, all you could hear were summer sounds, natural sounds, and the winters were even quieter. You felt all locked in at home. But at least it was safe and warm, and there was no noise. Just birds and that in the rafters.
Burraford?
It's a village near Harrogate. It's where we used to live.
When?
Some years ago.
18 years ago.
Yeah, something like that. We were happy there.
I knocked pretty loudly on the door number 91. There was no reply. Had a look outside. The house is quite secure. The curtains were drawn to the downstairs windows.
Did you get to speak to the neighbours?
Yeah, a family number 89. They hadn't seen her for about a week either.
Any of them know where Miss Sheridan works?
No, I asked them. And the people at that end of Broadacre Lane seemed to keep very much to themselves. They did have a few things to say about the Chamberlains, though.
What things?
Well, they reckon the Chamberlains are a bit dippy. And when I asked them if they'd noticed anything unusual happening during the past week, they said yes. Mr. Chamberlain has always gone to and from work by car.
Yeah.
Always. Except one day last week, when his butcher's van was parked in his driveway for the whole day.
Which day?
Wednesday.
It's the day that Chamberlain has off. It also happens to be the last day that he and his wife saw Miss Sheridan. I think we'd better circulate this woman.
I've got a full description of Louise Sheridan from her neighbours. Thought we might need it.
You're right, we do.
It's a smartly dressed woman, apparently. Tall, dark hair, brown eyes. Aged between 45 and 48 years old.
Aged what? Oh, the Chamberlain said she was only 30.
Not according to the people I spoke to.
You better put this out on the 584, Tony.
Oh.
Right, briefly.
Wednesday.
Yes, the day you say you last saw Miss Sheridan.
We were at home, of course.
Together?
Yes, I don't work on Wednesdays.
But your van was at home.
My van?
Yes, parked in your driveway. All day.
How do you know that?
You came here to report a missing person, Mr. Chamberlain. Naturally, we have to look into that. We have to ask around. Do you usually take your van home?
No, hardly ever. Anyway, what if I did? It's my concern, it's no one else's.
Of course it is. So why was the van there last Wednesday?
If you must know, I drove home in it the night before.
Why?
Because I had work to do, that's why.
What kind of work?
Look, this is ridiculous.
There were things to wash.
What things?
Muslins and aprons, all right. My wife always washes the muslins and aprons at home, in the machine. We prefer it that way, and it saves money.
The muslins and aprons from your butcher shop?
That's right. I usually bring them home in the boot of the car, but on this occasion, I use the van.
Why?
Because they were a bit messy this time, that's why. On Tuesday, there was a hold-up with the carcass delivery, and we had nothing in the cold room. So me and the lad who works with me went down to the abattoir to pick up some cuts.
Oh, I see.
And there were knives to sharpen.
Knives?
Yes, from the shop. I always bring them back on Tuesdays with the aprons and that. I've got a workshop in my backyard and a power grindstone. I always do the knives then. It saves time, and again, it's cheaper.
Well, you've both been a great help.
Good.
But there's just one thing that Sergeant Maitland and I don't quite understand. You see, you've described Miss Sheridan as being a woman of 30, but during our inquiries, we've learned that she's a good deal older than that. In fact, she's said to be in her mid to late 40s. How do you explain that?
Explain what?
Well, you getting a rager on by about 15 years. Keeps herself looking young, does she? Then again, maybe you just made a mistake. Is that it?
Yes. We made a mistake.
Who do they think they are, eh? They dress up thinking they're God's gift. They think they own the world just because they've been born with money and had education handed to them on a plate.
Who?
And they think that gives them the right to make all the noise in the world. Does it? Just because they think they're something special? Because they think they look good? Look desirable?
Who needs quiz nights when you get the Chamberlains? Sarge.
What?
Any chance of getting someone out to Broaddick Lane again?
Yeah, it's possible. Why?
Mr. Chamberlain's got a workshop in his back garden. I think he should be getting them once over. The same with his shop and his van. They ought to be checked out as well. OK?
June?
Yeah. Yes, Reg?
Is Sergeant Maitland about you?
Yeah, why?
Well, that lady we've all been looking for, she's just come home.
Those people are insane! They're always causing trouble.
Well, he is.
What sort of trouble?
Complaints about noise. I mean, what noise? I am not a noisy person. Apart from that, I'm hardly ever in the house. And now this, I come home to find my place full of police and police cars in the road and the neighbours almost sitting outside in armchairs to take a good look. And all because of those people.
They thought you'd gone missing.
Gone missing? How would they know if I was missing or not? I told you I'm hardly ever at home. I go away on business a lot. I have been away for the past few days. I've been in Birmingham. I've a good mind to bring charges against them. Can I do that? Just why do they resent me so much? I don't even know them. I have never spoken to them. They just happen to live next door.
So how did Mr. Chamberlain make his complaints?
Oh. I'd get rude little notes shoved through the letterbox, or they'd be hammering on the wall. They are. They're crazy. He even threatened me in one of his stupid notes.
What did it say?
Oh, I don't really remember, except that it ended something like, "Think yourself lucky to be alive."
Do you still have this note?
No, of course not. I threw it away.
Do you have any of the notes?
No. Noise? What are they talking about? Apart from a bit of traffic on the road, this is one of the quietest areas I've ever lived in. I think the noise is all inside their heads.
So that's it, then? You tell them to go home?
No. Not yet. There's still something wrong. I'd like to separate them. Give his wife a chance to talk on her own for a change. Is that all right?
OK. June, show Mr. Chamberlain through to a separate interview room, please.
Yes, Sarge.
Excuse me, Sarge. That information you wanted from North Yorkshire Police makes good reading.
Without Christine?
Well, I'll be here too. Can I get you another cup of tea?
But I don't like being on my own. Not without her.
Mrs. Chamberlain, what did you mean when you said you made a mistake about your next-door neighbour's age?
It's easily done.
A difference of 15 years, are you sure?
We never saw to talk to. And we only ever saw from a distance. Mostly through the curtains. Neck curtains.
I'm sorry, but I still find that difficult to believe. Then again, perhaps it wasn't your mistake. Perhaps it was your husband's. Do you think he could have perhaps made up his mind to mistake her for someone else?
Who?
A woman from a long time ago, 18 years ago.
I don't know what you mean.
Just making a bit of a guess, but I'd say your husband is not a well man. Am I right, Mrs. Chamberlain?
He's fit. He's always been fit.
In his body, maybe, but not in his mind. Tell me, whose idea was it to come here and report Miss Sheridan's disappearance? Yours or your husband's?
We both decided.
You and your husband have caused us a great deal of trouble, Mrs. Chamberlain. Now you must tell us the truth.
It was my decision to come here.
Why? To protect your husband and possibly Miss Sheridan?
From what?
From what might have happened. Did you ever know a family named Beaumont? A woman of 30 named Pamela Beaumont, and her parents both in her 60s. Are you sure you don't remember them? You see, they lived in the same small village where you and your husband both lived, Burraford, in Yorkshire. But something terrible happened to that family. Do you remember? They were all murdered. Hacked to death one summer day. The bodies were discovered in the manor house that they lived in, but the person responsible was never found. That was 18 years ago. People said it was probably a burglary that had got out of control. These people were wrong, weren't they? We know that now. It's time now, Mrs. Chamberlain. It's time to tell the truth. Isn't that why you came here in the first place? Come on now. Please. Tell us.
I knew she was going away for a while.
Miss Sheridan?
Yes. I could tell. I looked through the window and I saw her. She came back early from work, then she went out again with a large suitcase. Taxi was waiting for her. My husband didn't see her. He was sharpening the knives in the workshop. I didn't tell him I'd seen her. I was so glad she went away. He'd got her mixed up again, you see. In his mind, he thought it was those people again.
The bones?
Yes. He could still hear the noise they used to make. Still feel hurt by the way they used to treat him. But anyone else who was struggling to make a living. They were bad people.
They didn't deserve to be killed.
No. When he brought the van and the aprons home, I knew what he was going to do. Because he'd done it before. When I heard the sound of those knives being sharpened, it brought it all back. So I told lies and I brought him here. I had to. He had to be saved, you see. Saved from himself.
Right, Mr. Chamberlain.